Stanislav Grof. In the mid-1950s, Stanislav Grof, a Czech American psychiatrist, became aware of the possibilities of LSD and LSD-based psychotherapy. He himself had had overwhelmingly powerful experiences while under the influence of the drug, and had become convinced of its vast potential as a healing medicine and a tool for exploring and mapping human consciousness. Moreover, his experiences led him to dedicate the rest of his life to the exploration and charting of human consciousness, both with and without the use of psychedelic substances. He soon discovered that the scope of the prevalent Freudian model of psychoanalysis was far too narrow, and he spent decades devising a new expanded model of consciousness, including the unconscious. Grof's consciousness model is the most comprehensive of its kind, integrating contemporary depth psychology, the wealth of experience acquired by the great world religions, mysticism, and wisdom traditions, and profound insights in human nature from earlier cultures. Grof divides consciousness into three main layers. The first is a biographical layer, which covers the period from birth and onwards. Freud has dealt exhaustively with this layer of consciousness, which covers the oral phase, the anal phase, the genital phase, etc. Grof refers to the next deeper layer as a pre- and perinatal layers. The prenatal phase is a period of gestation in the mother's womb, while the perinatal phase covers a period immediately before, during and after the birth. He divides this layer into four subphases, which he terms basic perinatal matrices, BPM 1 to 4. BPM 1 covers the early stages of the fetus in the womb. The womb can be positive or negative, depending on the state of the mother's consciousness and her physical health during pregnancy, and whether the baby is wanted or not. If the womb is positive, this phase is usually experienced as paradisical. If not, it is experienced as unpleasant, or in the worst cases, as a sort of hell. BPM 2 is a phase during which the birth begins, labour sets in, and the womb exposes the fetus to heavy pressures from all sides, while the cervix is closed so that the fetus, baby, cannot escape from the unpleasant situation. This phase is usually experienced as a sort of hell, or as a no-way-out situation. BPM 3 is the actual expulsion of the fetus via the birth canal. The cervix is about to open and the fetus is on its way out. This is often experienced as a sort of purgatory, a life and death struggle which can be just as painful as the experiences of BPM 2. This phase is very dynamic, unlike the second phases, which is more static and rigid. The problems related to the sex-life-death triad are important elements during this phase. BPM 4 is the actual delivery. The birth process is complete once the baby has fully emerged from the womb. If the birth takes place in optimal circumstances, this phase is always experienced as very positive, as a state of bliss. But it is more dynamic than BPM 1. Although it has been established that BPM 1 is a root of the serene and purified form of ecstasy, which Grof calls oceanic ecstasy, it has also been shown that BPM 4 is the origin of the dynamic expressive form of ecstasy, described by Grof as dynamic volcanic ecstasy. It seems that these are the two forms of ecstasy that human beings are capable of experiencing. It has been empirically demonstrated that experiences in the womb and during birth exert profound influence on the psyche, shaping the subject's personality and general perception of the world. If the individual has been exposed to unpleasant experiences during BPM 2 that have not been properly processed in psychotherapeutic sessions, he will, to a large extent, regard life as meaningless. If he has had positive experiences during BPM 1, the world will, by and large, be perceived as paradise. And if BPM 3 has been marked by particularly negative experiences that have not yet been fully processed into psychotherapeutic process, life will usually be experienced as a struggle, often as a life and death struggle. The three birth matrices, BPM 2, 3 and 4, which represent the three distinct phases of the actual birth, also serve as templates for the process of human change, or inner process of death and rebirth. Grof makes the point that we are born physically, but not psychologically. To become whole human beings, we must therefore be born again. The fact that the birth process is complete, that we have emerged from the womb, does not mean that we are complete human beings. This requires a further process of psychological and spiritual development. The physical birth of a human being is never complete, because the psyche is incomplete. The psyche can be fully formed only upon attainment of adulthood, which is achieved by working on oneself along psychotherapeutic spiritual lines. If the individual is to become perfectly balanced, cleansed and spiritually pure, he must reenact his own physical birth, fully and completely reliving his own death-rebirth transformation. A core experience of this process is the sensation of what Grof terms ego death and rebirth. In the course of the psychotherapeutic purification process, the four BPM phases are experienced, usually in the following sequence: BPM 2, BPM 3, BPM 4, and finally BPM 1. If psychotherapy leads to such deep regressions that the individual encounters prenatal and perinatal experiences, he will have so-called transpersonal experiences at the same time. The latter are defined as experiences transcending the usual ego limits and the usual limits of time, space and causality. In Grof's consciousness model, transpersonal experiences constitute the deepest layer of consciousness, overlapping the prenatal and perinatal layers, so that the prenatal and perinatal experiences are, to a great extent, fused with the transpersonal experiences until the individual has used psychotherapeutic tools to rid himself completely of incomplete prenatal and perinatal past events. Transpersonal experiences can also crop up in connection with psychotherapeutic regression to infancy. But in most cases, they emerge in connection with the even deeper regressions to the pre- and perinatal layers of consciousness. In the transpersonal layer of consciousness, the individual can sense that he has entered an earlier incarnation, that he is on another planet, that he is an animal, a plant, a stone. He experiences prehistoric events, such as the formation of the solar system. He experiences parapsychological phenomena, out-of-body experiences, and mythological events. He can experience deities, God, or the supercosmic void. In this layer of consciousness, there is, in fact, no limit to experience. According to Grof, this is where every human being has access to information on any subject in the entire universe, both at the physical and psychical level. The result of inner experiences depend to a large extent on the extent to which we are capable of interpreting them and placing them in a meaningful context. Since becoming familiar with Grof's model, I felt in tune with it. To me, this map was profoundly meaningful and it provides a perfect framework for my shamanistic experiences. In 1987, I fathered a daughter. My first record was released, and I went on a European tour performing live on stage. I was divorced, I remarried, and we had a son. I cut a new record, went on several tours. I built my own therapy premises and music studio combined in a single unit. Late in the summer of 1993, I was divorced again, and now, for the first time in my life, I lived alone. In the summer of 1994, my life took a decisive turn in connection with my inner journey. It was now 10 years since my initiation crisis. At this stage, I had been in intensive psychedelic therapy for 7 years. I'd practiced yoga, studied and worked on my dreams. I had meditated and devoted as much attention as I could to my inner world. At the same time, I was keenly aware of the life and events that were taking place at the external level. On a balmy midsummer's eve, I went alone to my favourite beach to have a high-dose psilocybin mushroom trip. When I arrived home the following day in the mid-morning, after a formidable night that I'll never forget, I was surprised to discover that I was still pretty high. The effect of mushrooms usually lasts for 6 to 9 hours, and by now it was long past the upper limit. I perceived the world as if I'd taken 20 to 100 micrograms of LSD. This is only an estimate because I've never had the opportunity of knowing exactly how much LSD I've taken, apart from on a single occasion. I was puzzled, but I just got into bed. I needed some rest after the long night on the beach. When I awoke in the afternoon and got up, I was still just as high. The next day was the same, and the day after that, and a month later, and then a year later. I still haven't come down, fortunately. That night, I arrived in the land of the nocturnal butterfly. Without consciousness, there's no reality. Your current state of consciousness depends on which world you happen to be in. The kingdom of heaven is within you, as Jesus said. The land of the nocturnal butterfly is my paradise, my kingdom. Before I begin the story of my life, there are a few points I'd like to set straight. We live in an age flooded with psychotropic, mind-bending substances. Substances that alter your state of consciousness. Alcohol, coffee, cannabis, heroin, to mention just a few. There is, however, one group of substances that is clearly different from all others. The group referred to for several decades as psychedelic substances. These include LSD, mescaline, psilocybin, and ecstasy, to mention only the most important ones. In brief, these are substances that expand the user's consciousness. Recently, a new name has been proposed for these unique substances: entheogens, i.e. substances that, among other things, are capable of inducing religious experiences. Psychedelic substances, or entheogens, have been referred to in Native American cultures as the food of the gods. And when you consume them, you can, in the right circumstances, and in the most favourable situations, enter the kingdom of the gods, for a shorter or longer period. For reasons that are unscientific, illogical, and highly irrational, it is illegal to possess or consume the food of the gods in today's society. Just consider that fact. It strikes me as ridiculous that politicians should dictate what psychotropic substances I can or cannot take. Apart from the psychedelics, I'm a law-abiding citizen. I pay my taxes. I have a house, children, a job, a bike. On the whole, I live what is usually seen as a decent life. Virtually everyone in today's society is on some substance or other. Consider the facts. You may, of course, disagree with this line of reasoning. You may raise many objections, but do you drink coffee? Alcohol? Do you smoke tobacco? Do you take nerve medicine? Are you on sedatives? Do you eat chocolate? Sugar? Are you on heroin? Do you watch TV for 2 hours every day? Yes, TV can be a drug, although electronic rather than chemical. In other words, there is a high probability that you're on some substance or other that alters your state of consciousness. We all are, with very few exceptions. The substances we use may be different, but the vast majority of us are users of some substance. I have nothing against coffee. I really enjoy a beer now and then. And a bar of dark chocolate. Delicious! If you eat about 200 grams, you'll feel a delightful elation and a spreading sense of euphoria. But, to put it mildly, I'm highly irritated at not being able to buy my personal favourite substances legally. I have been working with psychedelic substances for more than 16 years. Now that's quite an apprenticeship. I arrived at the psychedelic buffet with an enormous appetite, and now I've sampled most of the delights. I'm fully convinced that it's just as natural to take psychedelic substances as to inhale the morning air. The only difference is that whereas we tend to take breathing for granted, eating the foods of the gods requires careful consideration. Back to the process. The night on the beach is a night of wonders. The Milky Way is clear in the sky far above. A sense of awe pervades my entire consciousness and body whenever I recall what happened on that night in 1984, 16 years ago today. It changed my entire life. It was like an invitation. The portal leading into the deeper layers of the mind, the universe, God was opened, and I heard God's earth-shattering roar. The journey of no return had begun. Like Odysseus, I was cast upon the waves on a tempestuous journey, far from home, but nonetheless heading for home. And now, dear reader, that I have come home, I'd like to tell you my story. Since 1983, I've kept an extensive journal of my experiences of inner space and also, of course, of my life in what we often call outer reality. The result is stacks and stacks of material. A consciousness researcher could probably make good use of it. Several folders filled with the session reports, 700 written accounts of dreams, and a lot of other material documenting the process I've been through. Serious scientists are welcome to study this material. I myself will attempt to present the findings, applying an approach based on the following four levels. 1. My psychotherapeutic experiences with and without psychedelics. 2. My dreams, visions and fantasies. 3. My life as it has taken shape in concrete terms in the outer physical material reality. And 4. An astrological approach. My journey has served as a sort of apprenticeship of modern shamanism, or of psychonautism. I learned the rules of the game of two distinct worlds, the inner and the outer. I've adopted 6 goals for this book, which I hope to fulfill in a manner that satisfies both writer and reader. 1. To establish that it is possible to recover from a bad high-dosage LSD trip. 2. To establish that a serious crisis offers a potential opportunity for profound spiritual change. 3. To show that psychedelic substances have other uses than adding an extra kick to a party. 4. To show that psychedelics can be incorporated in a successful life. 5. To describe the psychedelic process step by step, and thereby, 6. To achieve an improved understanding of psychedelics, the food of the gods. It is high time that we open our eyes to the potential of psychedelic substances as an invaluable tool for some people in their search for improved quality of life based on truer values. I'd better say this without delay. I don't think that psychedelic substances are for everybody, especially powerful psychedelics. Each of us must follow his own path. Some people simply don't need psychedelics. Others just can't handle them. Then there are others who need only a few single sessions, and so on and so forth, until we reach the type of person who is undeniably a psychonaut, whose fuel is powerful psychedelic substances. Some of the paths to freedom involve the use of psychedelic substances. Society must respect that fact, or learn to respect it. I strongly object to a society that claims to uphold the freedom of the individual and at the same time forces users of psychedelic substances to run the constant risk of breaking one or several laws, of being branded as criminals. In many cases, buying, possessing or using the substances is illegal. The consequences are detrimental to society. Crime, misinformation, drug abuse. They are negative for the individual too. Having to buy from the wrong people, no quality guarantees, high prices, guilt, shame, or even arrest and punishment. Some users are secret users, simply because they don't want to be regarded as criminals by misinformed friends and acquaintances. And this is very unfair, because most users of psychedelic substances wouldn't harm any living creature. Besides, I know what I'm doing is right for me. It's as simple as that. Consider my life. Am I thriving? Do I attend to my job? Is it a meaningful job? Do I take care of my children? Have I got a good home? Can I provide for myself and my loved ones? Is my life meaningful? Am I in good health? Go ahead. Ask any more questions that may be relevant. And the answer will be the same. Yes, yes, yes. Life is working out well for me. Of course I have my faults. I'm only human. Faults are part of life, and that's acceptable. As long as we learn from our mistakes and try to correct our faults. As I see it, I'm living proof that the proper use of psychedelics is healthy. In my opinion, the decisions taken by politicians and legislators to place most of these psychedelic substances on the list of the hardest and most dangerous substances, which ostensibly should have no therapeutic, medicinal or beneficial properties whatsoever, is an outright criminal act on the part of the state. I'm firmly convinced that we have to revise our perception of what substances should be regarded as appropriate or inappropriate. We must apply a scientific perspective and avoid prejudice to determine what is the appropriate and inappropriate uses of these substances. And there are several other aspects we shall have to consider. The global ecological crisis. How may we reach a sufficiently strong volition to act more closely in accordance with ethical principles that most people do today? Enough of this. It is time for me to begin the story of my life, from my birth to the present day, from the very beginning. Just one final point. Because of the situation outlined above, I'm compelled to remain anonymous. This means that although I've stated that I'm a musician, composer and performer, I may well be working in some other branch of the arts, painting, design, writing, acting, or... It also means that most of the names of people, cities and places have been changed for equally obvious reasons. But my story is true. Of that you can be certain. There are certain key concepts that I use frequently, which you must grasp firmly if my story is to make sense. For the reader who may not be familiar with them, I've added Appendix A at the end of the book. You might find the book more rewarding if you read this section first. Appendix B is a chronological listing of the most important events of my life. Use it whenever you're in doubt about the actual sequence of events or the dates. With regard to the concept of God, the divinity, and words for the Almighty, I subscribe to what is known as a cosmic religion. This means that I believe and feel that the core of all religions is the same, and that God, Allah, Dharmakaya, the Tao, and the Great Spirit, and so forth, are just different designations of the same entity. To make it easier for the reader to distinguish between the book's three layers, I use three different fonts. Minion Pro, for the main narrative, i.e. the straight story of my life up to 2000. Courier, for direct reports of sessions, dreams, etc. Minion Pro, Italic, for descriptions of the here and now, i.e. of what is happening in my life as I write this book. Now and then I deviate from strict chronological sequence, but the font will tell you where you are. Besides, I'll usually inform you when I narrate something out of sequence. Dear reader, brace yourself. Now begins a true account of my inner journey to the land of the nocturnal butterfly. Ellis Danielson.